Presentation by the Girl Scouts.
You may be seated.
So today is Girl Scout Sunday, and Troop 9012, who meets here, is here to help us out today. And I'm going to have them introduce themselves.
Hi, my name is Layla, and I'm a junior in Troop 9012.
Hi, my name is Tempe, and I'm a Daisy. Troop 9012.
Hi, my name is Kaylee. I'm a cadet in Troop 9012.
Hi, my name is Natalia, and I'm a junior in Troop 9012.
And it looks like maybe a couple of these girls just bridged, because I don't see many of the badges on your things yet. Did you guys just become juniors and just become a cadet? Oh, okay. So they still have to put their badges on them. I've spent many nights sewing those silly things onto to vests. Our troop always chose to do the vests because they didn't like the sashes. But yeah. So can you guys, let's do the Girl Scout pledge together. Anybody else who's out there who's a Girl Scout who knows this? On my own,
I will try to serve God and my country, to help people at all times, and to live by the Girl Scout law.
You guys are awesome. So I just want to talk briefly about Girl Scout Sunday while they're still up here. So this is Girl Scout Week, and it recognizes the founding of the Girl Scouts way back in 1912. It's been a long, long time. And we want to honor and thank the Girl Scouts in our community who have courage and confidence and character to try to make our world a better place. So thank you also to all of our adult volunteers who give of their time and talents to our Girl Scout troops, because it just is so amazing that you guys give of your time for that. So these girls
our future leaders. They are the leaders of tomorrow. And this organization that they belong to has adapted over its 100 years because the needs of Girl Scouts have changed over time. But one thing remains the same today as it did when it was first founded, and that's the support for girls to grow strong in their faith and a belief that the motivating force in Girl Scouting is a spiritual one. So let's join together, bow our heads, and say a prayer for these girls and leaders. Lord, help these young ladies to be good Girl Scouts, ones whom the world can trust. Help them to respect their neighbors' rights and never be unjust. Help them as Americans to be worthy of the flag they bear. Help them as real Girl Scouts to be proud of the uniform they wear. Help them to be clean, dear Lord, in thought, word, and deed. Help them to follow the law that is in the Girl Scout Creed. Help them to love people of all the world and to serve them. Help their actions to count, dear Lord, in everything they do. Help give them the strength to carry on and do their part each day. Make a place in this world for them, we pray. Make them what you desire them to be and to follow in your footsteps. Help them to live for others, O great troop leader of us all. Amen. Thank you, you guys. We much appreciate you being here, and we love that you are Girl Scouts and that you meet here. We love to provide that space for you. So thank you.
Thank you, Girl Scouts, and also Celebration Station to start this morning. Welcome to the 10:30 service at the Juda Zion Community Church on March 10th, 2024. A couple things that you may notice right off is that there's a few changes to the decorating in here. Want to share with you that we'll be having the cantata for One Voice both on Palm Sunday and on Good Friday at 1:30. So we hope you can attend and invite your friends and neighbors. And as Shelley always says, there's always snacks downstairs afterwards. So invite everyone. A couple announcements for this morning. We are going to have a short executive committee meeting downstairs after church in the fellowship hall. So if those that are part of that committee, if you would attend shortly after church, we'd appreciate it. On the calendar, the Women's Bible Study meets at Judy Catterley's on Monday night. The Outreach Committee is meeting this Tuesday night at 5:30. The Revelation Bible Study is at Pastor Kelly's on Wednesday at 1:30 p.m.
Actually, that's changed to be here. My house is going to be in mid-construction on Wednesday.
Still, okay.
Yes.
All right, very good. If you heard the change on that, that meeting will be here at 1:30. Also, please join us for our Lenten worship services on Wednesday night. We do have a quick potluck at 5:15 and then gather in the chapel at 6 for worship, and the choir will meet afterwards for cantata practice. Thursday is the Chosen Bible Study at 6:30 at the Mason House in Broadhead. Saturday, the men are going to the Iron Sharpens, which will be meeting here at the church at 5 a.m. To carpool down to Lamont, Illinois. So, Joe, thanks for your leadership on this, and I think we have 12 or 13 attendees for that. Just to note, the aluminum can collection for this month is for the SSM Monroe Hospice Home. And if you would, please sign the pew pads and pass them along the row. Also, a couple other things we have going on for Lent is Operation Smile, and I think Julie and I talked, we have at least 4 smiles going right now, so we appreciate everybody helping with that through the end of March. Also, we have the food pantry crosses in the back that indicates which of those items that we need, so if you could take those and bring them back and put them on the table back there. And then also, looking ahead into the April calendar, we will be having a shower potluck for EJ and Joyce in Fellowship Hall, and just to mention, we're also still accepting donations for them as well. Are there any other announcements that need to be shared this morning?
I'd like to add to Iron Sharpens Iron that is sold out and there is no room left for anybody else to come. I'm sorry if it's anybody else wanted to, but they don't have any more room.
Well, that's actually great news.
Praise the Lord that we got that many people going.
Absolutely. Thank you. All right, if you'd stand and join us in a call to worship. God of goodness and grace, Gather us in your arms of love. Gather us as people of your goodness and grace. Gather us in worship and prayer, that we may be strengthened with faith and courage. Gather us as those who are eager to live and to share your goodness and grace. Amen. And now we'll join in the hymn that will be on the screen.
Jesus of Nazareth, my friend has been paralyzed since childhood.
Tear off the
roof. That's a roof.
Put it back, man.
Just get me to Jesus, I don't care how. I don't have to wait to get the healing. I got a faith without a ceiling. So tear off the roof, cause the king's in the house. His power in the presence, power in the blood, power in the name of Jesus. His power in the presence, power in the blood, power in the name of Jesus. And he has more in the hand of his coming than they can buy the enemy. His power in the presence, power in the blood, power in the name.
been buried. And if old John was with us today, he'd tell us something like this. If you're on the line, girl, go the other way. If you got two coats, get one away. When Jesus comes, prepare the way. And don't forget your buds. Let me hear the 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
The 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
The 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
John the Baptist, 8 buds for lunch. Okay, second verse, just like the first. Here we go. Jesus said John the Baptist was great, the greatest man who ever lived. And if old John was with us today, he'd tell us something like this. Okay, say it with me. If you're on the line,
go the other way.
If you got two coats, get one away. When Jesus comes, prepare the way. And don't forget your buds. Let me hear you.
He ate buds for lunch.
Yuck,
yuck, yuck.
He ate buds for lunch. Give one away. When Jesus comes, prepare the way. And don't forget your buds. Bless the love, the 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
The 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
The 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
John the Baptist, 8 buds for lunch. Again, everybody, 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
The 8 buds for lunch.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
The 8 buds for lunch.
Did any of you eat the cricket crackers that we had for Vacation Bible School? Yeah, they weren't bad. I think I've probably eaten 3 different types of bugs in my life. You know, chocolate-covered ants. They were not bad. They tasted kind of like a crackle bar. They were kind of like that. No, the ones that have the Rice Krispies in them, they were kind of like that. And I think I've had crickets and grasshoppers.
Okay, you blinked on me. What were you going to say?
I was going to say, did you ever eat chocolate-covered tarantulas?
I did not. That's a little bit much for me. Those are pretty big. Now, we did, my kids made me eat dried, I think it was grasshoppers that we got at the museum. There was some type of a dried critter that they made me eat because my kids were mean, right? Would you do that to your parents? Would you make them eat dried bugs? No. Okay. Well, I couldn't wait to hear what it was that you guys were going to sing, and that turned out to be very cool. And it had to do with John, who we're talking about with the adults. But I'm going a completely different direction with you guys today because you guys know I was gone for quite a while, right? I was in a whole bunch of really cool places, and one of the places I went to was Hawaii. And have you ever seen where they give you something around your neck in Hawaii? What's it called? Do you know?
It's like a flower necklace or something.
Do you know what it's called?
A lei?
It's called it's not called a lei. You have to say it very carefully because every sound is pronounced in Hawaiian. So it's a lei. Yeah, you got to get that up. So, because lei is a different word there. So they give leis. And a lot of them are made out of flowers. Hold that thought for just a second. Some of them are made out of shells. Some of them are made out of leaves. These we made on the ship so that we had them when we went into Hawaii. And these are made out of ribbon. Now, the cool thing about leis is you're not supposed to make them for yourself. You're always supposed to make them to give away. And before I go on with that, I know you had something that's just eating at you that you want to share. What was it?
So I know a word in Hawaii, so this is kind of crazy. So I call my Nana, her name is Alice, right? Uh-huh. In Hawaii, Alice is Nana, and we call her Nana.
Okay. Very cool. And what did you want to share?
Me and my sister went to Tennessee, and
that's pretty far from Hawaii.
Yeah, I know.
It's fun.
And what happened in Tennessee?
Okay. Well, anyway, I wanted to share about this lei because what you're doing is you're making something to give away. And it's something that, you know, they can take a lot of time. I don't know if you've ever made one, but this took me a couple hours to make. It looks pretty simple, but I'm giving this to my mother today. Very excited to give it to her. But I was thinking about it and I thought, you know, we all have something to give away. All of us here, don't we? Because you all know about somebody very special. You all know about Jesus. You hear about him up here. You hear about him in the worship service. You hear about him in Sunday school. You hear about him at home. You hear the stories. But you know, there's a lot of the people that you go to daycare and school with who don't know anything about Jesus. So you guys, too, have something to give away. Because Jesus saves us. Jesus makes our lives so much better, and we want that for all of our friends, don't we? So when you think about these lays, I want you to think about giving Jesus away, okay? And you can just tell a story when somebody says, why do you go to church on Sunday? Let me tell you about Jesus, because Jesus loves me and Jesus loves you too, okay? Let's pray. God, thank you that you've come into our lives, but we know lots of our friends don't have you as a part of their lives. And help us find ways to share you with them, to give you away so that everybody can know who you are and be saved by you. Thanks for all of these young people today. Amen.
Well, this morning you'll notice that we're tying together during this Lenten season the journey of Jesus. Today we'll be talking about in the message something greater than John. And of course, our One Voice cantata starts out with John and his journey and through Jesus's through the time of sorrow to the end of Palm Sunday, Good Friday, and then into the celebration on Easter. So this morning, we're going to start with a scripture from Luke 2, 1 through 20, and this is how the One Voice starts. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Jesus went up to the town of Nazareth in Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over the flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news. It will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David is a Savior who has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven. And on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Well, good morning, everybody. This is our fourth week of Lent already, and I know the choir is feeling that a little bit, feeling like Holy Week's creeping up on them, but has this gone really fast for any of the rest of you too? It just seems like it zoomed by. Well, in our Sunday sermon series, we've been looking at the life of John, the forerunner for Jesus. And Jesus will even tell us in the Gospel of Matthew that John was the greatest man ever born to a woman. But today we're shifting a little bit. The long scripture that was hopefully very familiar to y'all from the second chapter of Luke focuses on Jesus. And the question that we're going to be focusing on today is, how can a Christian communicate that Jesus really is the Son of God, worthy and willing to receive all our praise and worship? Now, if you were here last week, we looked at the first chapter of Luke, the one that told the story of the birth of John the Baptist. And this scripture follows immediately after that. That's when he's telling us about the birth of Jesus. It's almost as if Luke is comparing the greatest man who ever lived to the only God who ever lived, Jesus. When John the Baptist was 6 months old, the emperor of Rome decided to number his people. Caesar Augustus wanted to make sure all of them were registered, and it wasn't for any to get extra funding to cover his people. No, it was because they were paying taxes, and he wanted to get his money. Now, this is the same Caesar who is credited with creating the Pax Romana, the Roman peace. Now, Rome controlled about a third of the world back then. It was huge. So Augustus was given credit for bringing pretty much what was worldwide peace at the time. As Roman emperor, Caesar was called the Savior, the Lord, by his citizens. A herald announced him anywhere he went. Make way. Okay, not Aladdin, but close enough. A choir accompanied him and sang his praises. So this is the one who decreed the census of the entire Roman world. He was interested in getting their property taxes, so he required people to register not where they were working, but where they owned property. The census forced this carpenter named Joseph to travel 90 miles south from his job in Nazareth to his ancestral home in Bethlehem. As a descendant of David, he and his brothers and cousins owned property up there. Now, Luke tells us that Joseph traveled up to Bethlehem, even though he was traveling south, but that's because Bethlehem was in the hill country of Judea. Nazareth is at about 1,100 feet, and Bethlehem's at about 2,500 feet, so it was an uphill climb. Most of the empire taxed the head of each household, but in Syria, they taxed women too. The only time women actually counted back in that time period. And that's why Joseph had to be accompanied by his pregnant fiancée. So when they arrived in Bethlehem, they had a dilemma, because Joseph's relatives also had come to register, so the house was brimming over with people. Master bedrooms full, living rooms full, even the place where the animals stayed was full. But Mary was going to give birth, so she needed some privacy and the privacy to dress and care for her newborn. So the couple chose to stay in the cave next to the house. The cave was where the animals would be housed during the winter. And it was then that all of heaven broke loose. You know, at first it was just one angel, just one. Shepherds are about 5 miles away from this, and they're in their field, and they're minding their own business. And the angel comes and announces the birth. Now, that announcement was followed by what they say is an army of angels of the heavenly host. They had been waiting for 9 months to sing this anthem song, "Glory to God in the highest and peace on earth to men." Luke doesn't record the decibel level, but it's almost certain that their singing woke up the shepherds' family members. The hills surrounding the fields are lined with caves that are part of the shepherd's field, because they lived in those caves. They didn't go back to a home. They were grubby, stinky shepherds, right? These caves today have become so sacred that they've become worship chapels today. People go there because the greatest news of all history was announced there. The shepherds decided to go and investigate this birth for themselves, and when they saw the Messiah in a manger, they were just overjoyed. Their response was to tell everybody that they saw that the Savior of the world was here. So those shepherds were the very first evangelists of the Christian era. They were Jesus' first worshipers. Now, Jesus' mom, Mary, took all of this in and thought about it deeply. What does this all mean? What's going to happen now that Messiah is come. You know, they'd all been waiting for Messiah for very many years. And now years later, she would tell all of this to Luke, who recorded it carefully so that we might know and believe. When he recorded this story, he wanted to make sure that nobody missed the point. Luke was convinced by the evidence that, number one, Jesus was greater than the greatest man who ever lived. And number two, he was greater than the most powerful man alive. So he wrote this story. And to tell us the story and to compare Jesus to John and to compare Jesus to Caesar. So how do they compare? Let's run them down. Well, both John and Jesus had miraculous births. John, we talked about, was born to elderly parents, far older than we would ever expect would be able to father and mother a newborn child. Jesus was born to a virgin. And without getting into it for our younger kids, which was the harder miracle? You know, being born to elderly parents is improbable, certainly, but being born of a virgin is impossible. So who wins that one? Jesus. Then there's the birth settings. Elizabeth gave birth in her home. Mary gave birth in Bethlehem. Elizabeth's delivery was normal. Mary's delivery in Bethlehem was 90 miles from home and in direct fulfillment of a 500-year-old prophecy given in Micah. Which is more impressive? Jesus. Jesus 2, John 0, right? Well, how about those announcements? Since Zechariah was unable to speak at the time, John's birth was announced by Elizabeth. Jesus' birth was announced by an angel. What do you think? Jesus. So let's compare the songs. Zechariah sang of John's birth. A choir of angels sang at Jesus' birth. How about the results of their births? Everyone who heard about John's birth was impressed. Everyone who heard about Jesus' birth was amazed. So final score, Jesus 5, John 0. For the greatest man who ever lived, right? Even from birth, the greatest man who ever lived can't compare to the only God who ever lived. So let's look then at Luke's comparison of Jesus and Caesar. Now, at that time, I mentioned Rome governed a third of the population of the earth. The ruler, Caesar Augustus, was so powerful, they called him August, which means majestic one. So how does this most powerful, majestic one compare to Jesus? Well, Caesar's birth was noble. Jesus' birth was humble. There was pomp and circumstance around the birth of any Roman nobleman. There was nothing pompous, only lowly circumstances surrounding the birth of Jesus in a cave. Now, I can't really score that one yet. We got to get some more facts before we can decide which is more impressive, because it depends on how you're going to measure impressive, right? So let's compare their heralds. Caesar's herald was a human. Jesus' herald was an angel. Who wins that one? Jesus. How about choirs? Caesar had a choir to sing about his glory. Jesus had an army of the heavenly host. Yeah, Jesus 2, Caesar 0. And maybe it's time for us to look back at that first one. If Jesus had all these resources at his disposal, to let himself have a humble birth so that we could identify with him, maybe one of the most impressive things about him. He was so impressive himself that he didn't need to impress us with an impressive birth. So Jesus 3, Caesar 0, and you can see where this is going, right? Well, how about their claims? In the first century world, everyone knew that Caesar was called Savior and Lord. Jesus is Savior and Lord. Now, by the time Jesus was through, everyone who investigated his accomplishments knew that Jesus was Savior and Lord. And you can see that in even just the chosen clips that we show during our song there, that people were just flocking to him. They knew that there was something special about Jesus. Well, how about their actions? Caesar demonstrated his power. He would issue a decree and say, "This is my word." God demonstrated his love by sending his son. Love is more powerful than any decree. So we're at 5-0. Well, finally, what about their motives? Caesar sent Joseph to Bethlehem to ensure that he would pay taxes.
God sent Jesus to Bethlehem to ensure that he would pay for our sins. Which one's more impressive? Wow. The God who cares for us, not the ruler who wants things from us. Most of the time, when we want to read the Christmas story, we start with Luke 2, verse 1, and we read that miraculous story of Jesus' birth. And that's enough for us. There's a lot in there, right? But when we step back and we take in the whole story in context, Luke is saying that this is a birth like no other. He's saying, compare Jesus to anyone, to the greatest of humans or the greatest of kings, and there is no comparison. In the time that Jesus was born, Caesar was the most powerful name in the world. Israel was just a backwater part of the empire, not very important. Nobody knew Jesus' names like Joseph and Mary. Today, how many people, how many cultures name their children Jesus, Jesus, Joseph, Mary, Maria, any of those? And we name our dogs Caesar, right? Now, to be fair, Augustus Caesar was so powerful that our calendar still has a month that's named after him. But we number that calendar by the birth of Jesus, don't we? We live in the year of our Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord, Savior, Messiah, and King. He is worthy of our worship, and that's why we sing to him. That's why people in churches raise their hands to him and bow their heads to him and kneel to him. That's why you should tell anyone who ever wonders if Jesus would want to be worshipped that Jesus has to be worshipped. He's the great one. We're his subjects. If in the future you're ever hard-pressed to come up with the words of how do you know this, just open up to Luke. Whoever you're comparing to Jesus, Jesus is greater. No rival, no equal. His is the name above all names, and he came to give to us because he didn't need anything from us. He only wants things for us. His name is Jesus, in Hebrew, Yeshua, which means Savior. He came to save us from the justice we deserve for the things we've done wrong. He came to offer us forgiveness, and he came to bring eternal life. Nobody else in our entire world has ever done that, because nobody else ever could. Let's pray. Jesus, you have no equal. No one else has ever claimed to be fully human and fully God. We are so grateful that you came down to earth, and we thank you for your ministry as you walked on the earth. But most of all, we thank you for your sacrifice for us. Help us to find the words to share this with our relatives and friends and neighbors who aren't believers. It's hard, but with your help, we can do all things. Praise be to you. Amen. Our offering is still gathered up in the back, but will you join me now in a prayer over our offerings? Merciful God, you have richly blessed our lives with love and bounty beyond measure. Bless these gifts we return to you now that they may bestow the same richness of your love and grace in the world. Amen. Our next hymn is hymn number 300 in the hymnal, All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Thank you.
years. And Julie and Angie, how's Dad doing? Is he back on his feet yet, or slow recovery, or where are we at?
Getting there. He had blood work done on Monday with all of primary, and everything came back good. So
blood work's good. He's getting better, but we'll continue to pray for him for a couple weeks for that healing process. Continuing to pray for Bella and her baby. It looked like they were home. Is that correct? Does anybody know? They had been up at Madison at Children's, but it looked like in the pictures they might be home now. But continuing to pray for them and healing. Peggy's niece, Carly, is on dialysis, still needing to gain some more weight, so she is in need of our prayers that hunger and that ability to eat may just put on a few more ounces every week, that she may be stronger for her surgery. We continue to pray for all of those dealing with cancer, for Judy's cousin Tammy and Connie Hyman and Cindy Dunwoody, Shelley's stepdad Gene, Angie's friend Jennifer, Bob Wunschel, Tommy's brother-in-law Mike, and EJ's friend Pete. And then we continue to pray for EJ and Joyce as you guys are figuring out your next steps and how are things going. Joe, maybe you could get EJ or Joyce a microphone there. How are things progressing? One foot ahead of the other. Have you got plans for building now, or?
We're getting more in order.
Okay. Well, that's got to be exciting to see something coming again from nothing. But prayers for you guys that's a lot. It's just a lot. What else are we lifting up today, folks?
How about those of us? Mic on, Calvin? Those of us that are traveling down to Lamont, Illinois for Iron Sharpens Iron, safe travel down there.
Okay, safe travel and travel mercies. And
we're welcoming anybody who wants to pray for us overall for during the time that we're down there as well.
Okay. Those are such amazing spiritual events, and I just pray that everybody who goes comes back all energized on fire for God. I missed part of that. I heard bull, and that's never a good...
No, an acquaintance in Oklahoma was mauled by a bull, and he had back surgery last night. He's an elderly gentleman. His name is Jody.
Okay. That sounds absolutely terrible. All right, let's turn our hearts and minds to God. Gracious, loving Savior, we are so grateful that you came as a human in this humble birth that we've been talking about, and you walked around on earth, and you did these amazing things, and you showed us what the law was meant to be, because we don't get it, and we still don't get it. So we need you in our lives guiding us. We need that direction each and every day. When our hearts get hardened, continue to soften them. When we think of others in need, let us lift up a prayer to you, especially those that we know us right now we're lifting up for healing or in their situations. Lord, you are so amazing. You are so powerful. You created everything that we know by speaking it, and it's amazing. We thank you that you made all of this, that you made us, and that you call us good. And that you love us so much that you sent Jesus for us. In this time of Lent, we can't just gloss over that fact. We have to absorb it. We have to know that we are worthy of your love. We are so very blessed. God, as we pray the words that Jesus taught us, we lift this all up to you, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you all to stand now. I'm not sure if this is a real familiar hymn, so you might want to grab out a hymnal. It's hymn number 292, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne. Go forth in light and love and share them with the world that needs them so badly. In Jesus' name, amen.